Figure skating competition will be seen tomorrow night on our primetime show. It begins at 7 o'clock Eastern time. That's a special starting time for us tomorrow for the men's final. For a report on the event, here's our own Scott Hamilton from the venue called White Ring.
The men's short program, a night when you face your greatest nightmares and your biggest dreams. What could be your last Olympics? It is the most important 2 minutes and 40 seconds of your life. 2 years ago, America had no idea who Michael Weiss was. Last night, he skated in his very first Olympic Games. His first element is connecting steps into triple lutz. Huge, gorgeous triple lutz. Little variation on the landing there with the arms crossed. Difficult.
I was really inspired and went out and had a nice first jump, good triple lutz, and the program felt really solid, and I felt good going into to the triple axel, but obviously the takeoff was a little backwards, and I was a little open in the air. That resulted in the spill, but, you know, there's eight elements in my short program, and, the other seven elements felt solid. Unfortunately, the triple axel is one of the important ones. It was nice to realize that my dad was, a big part in it, and to look up there and see him very proud of me, finally making the Olympic team and representing the United States. He told me, to be confident, and you're still right in this. You can still salvage a great program. And going out there, I have a good, solid, long program, and performing like I did at the national championships, and I can go after this quad now because there's really no pressure.
Combination, spin, speed, position, variance of position. Good speed. Clean, perfect, beautiful short program under extreme pressure from Todd Eldridge. Place after the short program, Todd is still in contention for the gold, but there's a question whether Eldridge needs to do the quadruple jump. He'll skate after first place Ilia Kulik, who is certain to do the quad.
It really doesn't matter what he does as far as whether I do it or not. It's more how I feel. If he goes out and does it, fine, that's great for him, but it's something that if I go out and do it and I don't feel great with it and I miss it, then we're in jeopardy of losing a spot on the podium.
When it comes to the quad, there's no doubt that Elvis Stoica will have it in his long program. That's what he does. But his greatest strength is also a weakness. Elvis is true to himself. He's not Baryshnikov, Astaire, Kelly. Elvis is a karate-kicking, dirt-biking, rock-and-rolling, quadruple-toe-looping kind of guy, and he has trouble getting the presentation mark. Ilia Kulik, on the other hand, has no trouble getting a mark first, second, artistic, athletic. He's a very balanced skater, very artistic, and the judges really like what he does. But what put him in first place in the short program was this. Ilia Kulik is probably the purest, most beautiful technical jumper to ever grace this sport.
Ilia Kulik is taking aim at the top and anyone who stands in his way.
Don't worry, I wouldn't shoot you.
If you're standing between Ilia and the Olympic gold medal, there aren't a whole lot of places where you're safe.
It's keeping me strong. It's keeping me in a good shape.
At 20 years old, Kulik isn't lacking for charisma or for confidence.
I feel really good after this.
Very good.
Ilia has that edge that I think, you know, drive young women crazy and make, you know, judges and coaches go nuts.
He is just so talented. I mean, he really, if he nurtured it, he could be just brilliant, just incredible.
He could be, you know, the best we've ever seen.
I heard a couple of times that I'm talented, you know, and the people told me from my childhood.
When Kulik burst onto the scene as a rosy-cheeked 17-year-old at the 1995 European Championships, greatness was predicted. When he won a world silver medal 1 year later, that greatness seemed assured. But for 2 years, Kulik was a model of inconsistency. Once the question was when, by this season it had become if.
It's getting to the fork in the road that he really needs to sort of be a, you know, be a champion.
I believe that's time for him to really show who he is, how strong he is.
Sometimes I didn't struggle enough. I didn't struggle to the end. And that was part of my, you know, it was my weakness. You know.
But in a 21-day span in November and December, Kulik won first the NHK trophy here on the Olympic ice, then Russian nationals, and finally at the Champions Series final, he beat both Todd Eldridge and Elvis Stoiko to establish himself as a strong gold medal contender. Suddenly, those doubts seemed a long way away.
You know, my head is changing. My body seems the same, but the head changing a lot because of the age, and I'm realizing a little bit more things about the life and about the skating also. So I'm different. I'm really different from last year.
What is not different is the reaction Kulik gets from members of the opposite sex. But if you think his is the life of a skating stud, you might be surprised. Kulik's most frequent companion at his rustic New England home in Marlborough, Massachusetts, is his coach, Tatiana Tarasova. And when he's not skating, this is usually where you'll find him. Not exactly the life of a handsome bachelor.
When the practice is bad, the practice is real bad. Just coming home and sitting alone, and you know, in your mind it's all around and skating, and it's awful.
Without the distractions, Kulik can focus on living up to his billing as figure skating's young Baryshnikov.
I'm not trying to be like him, but I'm admiring him, and he's big influence on my skating.
At the age of 20, Ilia Kulik has earned the respect of many of this sport's greatest names. Now he hopes to join their ranks. Ilia Kulik will be the first to skate in the last group tomorrow night. Todd Eldridge second. Elvis Stoiko will skate last.
A bit of showmanship, just compassion from one skater to another. Eldridge leaves Nagano and the Olympics having never won a medal, but his contributions and accomplishments in the sport will never be in doubt as a former world champion and five-time national champion, Todd Eldridge. Taking a look at the medal standings so far.
Well, we all know, Gretchen, it is indeed one of the premier events of these Winter Olympic Games, and American Todd Eldridge had his mind set on winning a medal. However, as far as the men's figure skating is concerned here in Nagano, it belongs to only one man, and it is not Todd Eldridge.
In the end, it wasn't even close, as Russia's Ilia Kulik used skating's most difficult jump to soar to victory.
Yes! 1 foot! Totally in control!
Kulik's quadruple toe loop was the highlight of his flawless free skate, and his incredible set of jumps proved to be too much for the rest of the field. Canada's Elvis Stoiko was the early favorite going into the event, but he settled for the silver medal after a flat and uninspired program. He also had to battle a groin injury and had to be helped off the ice after his routine. And help is something American Todd Eldridge needed a lot of. He entered the night in third place, but a sloppy set of jumps dropped him right on out of medal contention. It was a very disappointing performance for the five-time U.S. champion, but he remained upbeat and philosophical in defeat.
Yeah, obviously it wasn't the performance that I wanted to do today, but
you know, I'll have to take it. It's the way it goes. You know, not everybody skates their best at the Olympics. And it's a tough thing to take, but we'll move on and hopefully have better performances from here.
And Eldridge's shaky performance allowed Francis Felipe Candelero to go in and to win the bronze medal, and another shaky performance for Todd Eldridge, and probably his last and final Olympics. Kind of sad for him, but yeah, he's just happy that he was able to participate and represent his country.
Yeah, what a wonderful experience.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah.
Well, now to
come back to CBS coverage of the 18th Olympic Winter Games.
Welcome back to Nagano, everyone. With the men's figure skating final hours away, we now bring you an insider's guide to the competition. Brian Boitano was the 1988 Olympic champion in Calgary and a two-time world champion. He joins us today from San Francisco. Hi, Brian.
Hi, how you doing?
I'm great, thanks. It's great to see you. So we're watching the other night, and it's clear that the judges really liked Ilia Kulik's classical style, but a lot of us were blown away by Elvis Stoiko. What did you think?
You know, I think that you are right. I think that the judges were sending a signal that that people have been feeling that Kulik is really the judges' choice because they feel that he's an all-around skater. They've been on a downswing with Elvis in the last few years because they feel that he's only an athlete. And I think that they sent that message out last night. But you know what? I think that the top four were all great. I mean, it really could have gone any way depending on the judges and what they prefer.
So assuming that everyone skates cleanly then tonight, are you saying that maybe Elvis, there's a bias against his masculine style and maybe no matter what he does, he wouldn't be able to win the gold?
Well, no, not necessarily. I mean, I think if anyone can skate well in that last position, it's Elvis. I think it's a prime position for him because he is such a fighter. He has really been focused on this for years. He has his own style. He believes in it. He's a great athlete. He's a great technician. And if anyone's going to cinch that last place and get the marks that they're saving up for that last place, it's going to be Elvis. I mean, I don't know if any other guy could skate in that position besides Elvis.
Brian, so much has been made about Todd Eldridge in the quad. Do you think he's decided now what he's going to do, or is he going to wait till tonight to decide?
You know, I certainly hope he's decided before now what he's going to do. I mean, I really am under the belief that you decide before you go to a competition what you're going to do. Because once you start changing programs and once you start changing mind thoughts, it changes the entire chemistry of your performance and the entire chemistry of your fighting ritual.
So the follow-up question would be then, do you think he needs it in order to win the gold medal?
No, I really don't. I think that at this point, and I've said this all along, I think the quad is a tiebreaker. I think that if all those guys go out, I think what people are looking for is a great, clean, wonderful performance, you know, with eight triples. And if someone does eight triples in a great performance and a quad, then it might be a tiebreaker. But it might only be a tiebreaker for the athletic mark, for the mm-hmm. first mark. But you still have to consider the artistic impression mark, which is the second mark, and it can go either way on that.
As long as we're talking about Todd Eldridge, how happy were you, Brian, to see him skate so well? I mean, does it seem to you like he's sort of exercised his Olympic demons finally? He looked like he was really having a good time the other night.
Yeah, you know, I heard him say when he got off the ice that he was thinking going into the simple double axel about the other Olympic experience where he fell on that. And that was probably his biggest challenge, is doing probably the easiest of all the elements in the short program. But you know what? Todd is a great fighter. Todd knows exactly what he has to do. And if Todd does what he can do in practices, I feel confident watching him because I know he is totally in control. He knows how to compete. He knows how to skate. And if he's doing what he can do within his capabilities on practice, he can do it. He can put it out there in front of the judges.
Of the four guys in contention, who do you think is the best pressure player? Who's going to handle all of the pressure on the ice tonight the best?
You know, I have to say that I think that probably Elvis and Todd are two great pressure skaters. And I think the hunger that Elvis has puts him over the top. I mean, so if I were to say, you know, I can't choose which one skates better in competition. I mean, I think they both are really great athletes in competition. But I think that Elvis's hunger and his focus, he's so intense, and he knows exactly what he wants to achieve out there, that that puts him over the top.
Kulik seems to be a little bit more mature, though, than he used to be, doesn't he? I mean, it seems like in the past, hasn't he had that, he does really well in the short program, and then by the time he gets to the free program, his marks tend to fall off. Do you think that he's showing some more maturity, though, able to maintain a high level?
Well, you know, he may be showing more maturity, and I think he has a long ways to go. I mean, he's so young. He has another Olympics inside of him. He's going to learn a lot more from this experience in the next 4 years as well. You know what? It's a normal pattern to improve as you go on. Learn things about yourself. Learn what works. Learn what doesn't work. And put it into play. It doesn't seem like he's under that much pressure. He doesn't seem to... seem to have that nervous energy. It's not all that important to him. It's like, you know, going out and doing what he does in practice, and that's his attitude. And that might be good, but that might be bad as well, because it won't match up to the hunger that I feel that Elvis has.
So what do you expect to see tonight? Do you think we're going to see a little more fire out there? It's kind of seemed to go pretty even the other night. What do you think we'll see tonight?
It was really even the other night. I agree with that. It was a lot of really good performances, but I really felt like the guys were saving it up for the long program, because that's when they need to go all out. I really have the feeling that Elvis, depending on if he's really ill, you know, from the flu, it's going to be hard to have the strength to go through an entire long program and do everything that you want to do.
Well, we have to ask him how he thinks things are going to end up, right?
Yeah.
So
your prediction.
Yeah, Brian?
Really? Do I really have to give you a prediction?
give us 1, 2, 3.
I think that Kulik or Elvis will be number one, and I think that Todd will be second.
Okay. Brian, thank you very much.
So I don't know why, but yeah. Yeah, thank you.
Thanks for being with us, and enjoy the competition tonight. Brian Boitano.
You.
You know, I have to tell you that Elvis Stoiko's mother is Hungarian, and I had told him several months ago that if he won the gold here in Nagano, that I would make him chicken paprikash. So we're going to have to find some paprika.
Better find the
in the kitchen.
Absolutely. We'll return with more from Nagano right after these messages.
If you look into the eyes of these skaters, you see they've prepared their whole career for a day like this.
When it's not always raining, there'll be days like this. When there's no one complaining, there'll be days like this. Everything falls into place like the flick of a switch. Well, my mama told me there'll be days like this. When you don't need an answer, there'll be days like this. When you don't need a chance, there'll be days like this. When all the parts of the puzzle start to look like they fit, then I must remember there'll be days like this. Oh, my mama told me there'll be days like this.
About days like this, what a scene we have. Looks like a movie set as Mother Nature continues to make her presence felt at these, the 18th Olympic Winter Games. You know, the Olympics can actually trace their history back to the year 776 BC in Greece, and by comparison, this temple behind me is a relative newcomer, built some 1,300 years after the first Olympics in the 6th century. And hi again, everybody, and happy Valentine's Day to all of you. We're so glad to have you with us on this special edition of Olympic Primetime. These are actually the third Olympics that Japan has ever hosted. Back in 1964, Tokyo hosted the Summer Games, and in 72, north of here, Sapporo welcomed the winter crowd. And now the Nagano Games have reached the midpoint with still plenty of drama to unfold in the week ahead. And again, on this special edition of Olympic Primetime, we have the men's figure skating final for you. You will see Ilia Kulik of Russia, who led the field going into the free skate. Canada's Elvis Stoiko was in second, while America's Todd Eldridge was in third. In addition to figure skating, tonight we've got a premier event in speed skating, the women's 500-meter race. We'll update you on Dream Team Hockey as well, as the United States and Canada continue their play here. But right now, I'm heading back inside, so pull up a chair for this special edition of Olympic Primetime, the men's figure skating final. We'll start there at White Ring with Verne, Scott, and Tracy when we continue from Nagano in just a moment.
Representing Japan. We welcome you to White Ring, a big night in the 1998 Olympic winner gains the men's free skate. Still early in the evening, but this place filled to capacity, 7,300. Many of them anticipating this moment. On the ice, only 16, but already twice the Japanese national champion. Here is Takeshi Honda. The music from the movie El Cid.
At 16 years old, this is a skater you want to keep your eyes on. He's ultimately talented. Opening with triple axel, triple toe loop combination. Triple axel, no combination, but a beautiful triple axel. He's got a quad in his arsenal. If he's gonna do it, it'll be right here. Nope, triple flip, beautiful. But he pulled it off. Again, at 16 years old, he's got two more Olympics in him before he even hits his prime. Still young, the way he presents himself. Japanese men's figure skating history have had consistency year after year. They tend to make the crucial mistake. They also struggle with their choreography. This is something that Takeshi does not struggle with at all. He's a very lyrical skater. Another triple axel. This one has to be in combination. Step out, it's a little too big, over-rotated. But of all the men I've seen compete for Japan, he's got all the tools. He continues to develop. Wow. It's going to be something very special. Takeshi Honda, remember that name because you're going to be hearing it for years to come. What a talent.
Here's coach Galina Smievskaya. Takeshi Honda, injured for the Japanese championships this year, given a spot on the team, now spending much of his time in Simsbury, Connecticut, where he works under the tutelage of Galina Smievskaya, who coached Oksana Bayul and Victor Petrenko.
Another look at the triple axel. You can see he's up. Look at the height. The air position is just gorgeous. That was the one that was supposed to be in combination. Watch Galina going, okay, come on, speed, speed, speed. Come on, speed. Move it. Second axel again. Good height. It looked like he over-rotated it. Great feet. Look at how tight the feet are. Coming down, he's done rotating there. He needs the ice underneath him. You can see the left hip is gone. Couldn't stop the rotation, thus the fall.
Coming later tonight, the final group, and here are the standings after the short program. Ilia Kulik of Russia currently first. Elvis Stoiko of Canada second, followed by Todd Eldridge. Whichever of those three wins the short program, if one of them does, he will win the gold medal. Here are the marks for Takeshi Honda.
Excellent marks, 5 threes, 5-4 with a fall in the triple axel. And his second mark, check this out, goes up. One judge knocked it down, but this kid shows a lot of promise. 16 years old. Amazing.
Coming later tonight, United States silver medalist Michael Weiss. Back at White Ring, men's final, and on the ice, the bronze medalist in the 1998 Canadian Championships. Here is 22-year-old Jeff Langdon from Barrie, Ontario.
Call that a pop. When a triple axel turns into a single, it's a decision your body made without your permission, and it's embarrassing.
Sounds like you've been there only occasionally.
Been there, done that. Triple flip. Triple toe. He had no speed on the landing of that triple flip, and he still pulled it off. Sackout, triple loop. Oh, it's such a tough combination. To give you an idea how much, give an idea how things have changed in the sport of figure skating, that combination you just saw, triple sack, triple loop, won the world title for Kurt Browning. 1991. And to see these skaters doing these triple-triple combinations, two triple axels, quads, athletically the sport has changed so much. Triple axel, beautifully landed. Important after that first triple that he missed. But what is going to get the marks for these skaters is the presentation, the quality of the program, the difficulty of steps, and their presence on the ice, so crucial. That's what separates the top three guys from the rest of the field.
For 22-year-old Jeff Langdon. And the Canadian contingent is here, as they usually are.
He's got the jumps. He just really needs to skate with more power. Needs to be a little more in your face. But he'll be really thrilled with this performance. Difficult combination of triple flip into triple toe loop. You need to keep the speed after this triple flip. He's a little slow there. He's a little slow here, but he's strong enough to just crank that triple toe loop and land it somehow. Another difficult triple-triple combination. This triple sow, triple loop. The triple sow, you have to land this triple sow cow perfectly in order to get that triple loop up. And he's a little backwards in the air, and he hangs onto it, fights for it. He popped the first triple axel, and then he gets this second one, and I was shocked to see this. I thought his confidence might have waned a little bit, but look at that. Triple axel, lots of speed coming out. And his coach, Doug Lee, he knows how to coach a triple axel. He's like, yeah, and he knows after you miss the first one, the second one's really tough.
The marks for Jeff
and the first set of marks now for Jeffrey Langdon.
We got some great marks coming out early in the competition. You got to imagine, we still got a lot of guys to go, and he's 17th in the short. 5-5, and his second mark will probably be around the same, maybe a little lower. Again, it's impact skating. In order to get that second mark, you've got to be in the face of the judges. You've got to be doing difficulty in choreography. That's something he needs to work on.
You know.
Later. More men's figure skating. Plus the women's.
Takeshi Honda earlier in the evening. Galina Smievskaya has moved into the stands where she, like we, is getting ready to watch Vyacheslav Zagorodniuk, one of her former athletes. Slava Zagorodniuk from Odessa, Ukraine. He and his wife Olga moved to Richmond, Virginia in September of 1997. Competing in his second Olympics. Tough short program, but he now skates to music of Sergei Prokofiev, the theme from Alexander Nevsky.
With consistency. His opening triple axel, just huge, out of control. Worlds in 1989. Everybody's looking at him as being the next Viktor Petrenko. 1990, he was eighth at the World Championships. Triple toe loop. And he has not improved since then. So much promise, so much potential, unrealized.
He was, of course, Viktor Petrenko's colleague when they were both coached by Galina Smievskaya in Odessa. Viktor later married Galina's daughter. And that family now lives in Simsbury, Connecticut. Here's Slava Zagorodniuk and his wife living in Richmond, Virginia. Conditions in Ukraine simply awful for this sport.
Second triple axel, beautiful.
Trip to a podium in a major international event happened in 1994 in Japan. The Worlds were held in Chiba then, and Vyacheslav Zagorodniuk went home with a bronze medal.
You watch what he's capable of doing. And you wonder why he doesn't put it together more often. He was fourth at Worlds last year. Triple loop. Great technique in this triple loop. He doubles it. If you lose concentration for just a millisecond before you take off for a jump, you're doomed. You gotta stay confident, you gotta stay focused. And it seems like he just loses it. You think he's got it together, and he just backs off just for that second to make him miss the jump. Triple Lutz, double. You have to hit these jumps with total commitment. Final triple toe loop, 420 into his program.
Unfortunately, though, for Vyacheslav Zagorodniuk, as Galina looks on without much passion, this free skate kind of an on-ice summary of his career to date. Some highlights, but a few problems.
First triple axel, he was flying into this triple axel. Great speed. He steps up and he tilts it right to the left, right there outside. When you're tilted outside, you can see that left hip is still rotating when you land, and you can't save the jump. You've got to stop the rotation. The second one, much better. Watch the landing here. You see how his hip is in front, and he's able to save the jump. Choreography, very important. Interesting spiral, body angles. Just too many mistakes. Landed five triples, but if you want to compete with the best guys in the world, you better hit eight.
Zagorodniuk, accompanied by his coach Valentin Nikolaev, who also lives in Richmond, Virginia, and together they await the scores.
5-6 from Japan, so triple axel. 5-0 from Great Britain. Problems. Disparity.
Marks for presentation.
Again, you know, for a program that was so-so, these marks are pretty high. You're going to see a lot of high marks in that last group tonight, for sure.
5-6 and 5-6. Thank you. Yet to skate tonight, United States silver medalist Michael Weiss, and he'll skate a program choreographed by his wife Lisa. Entering White Ring now, the group of world and national champions who will compete for the men's Olympic gold medal later tonight. And here is the order in which they will skate. This determined by draw. Ilia Kulik will skate first. He is currently first. Todd Eldridge second. Alexei Yagudin is third. Stephen Cousins next. Philippe Candeloro will be fifth. And Elvis Stoiko, the current world champion, will be the last to skate. Hi once again, everybody. Verne Lundquist along with 1984 Olympic gold medalist Scott Hamilton. Not that a lot of time has passed.
Oh, have times changed.
You've lost a little hair, as have I, and now we're talking about the quadruple jump.
Well, this is our third Olympics together, and this is the first time that a quadruple jump will more than likely determine the gold medal winner. Ilia Kulik has a beautiful quadruple toe loop. Elvis Stoiko was the first man to do a quad-triple combination in competition. Todd Eldridge doesn't have one in his program tonight. A beautiful triple axel, triple toe combination at the beginning and another triple axel at the end of the program is as tough as his program gets. If he does a quad in his program, it's like doing a Hail Mary. He's praying and hoping that he can land it. And he probably won't need it if the other guys miss theirs. Any error in this competition could cost somebody the gold medal.
On the ice now, the American silver medalist who will attempt a quad tonight, but he'll try to grab a piece of history and become the first man to ever land a quadruple Lutz. Here's 21-year-old Michael Weiss from Fairfax, Virginia. 11th entering the free skate in his first Olympic Games. His dad, Greg, his mom, Margie, his two sisters, future brother-in-law, brother-in-law, and niece, all here. Music composed by Ludwig von Beethoven.
Let you know how difficult this jump is. I never thought in my lifetime I would see a quadruple Lutz. Good speed going in. A little short of rotation. He was so close. Now the situation is this. He missed the quad and he's got 8 triples. 2 triple-triple combinations. Triple axel. Triple toe! Huge hurdle there.
The day, and you were talking, Scott, about how significant the first Olympic Games is in establishing your identity in the sport.
It's so important to, you're going to be the heir apparent to a great American champion like Todd Eldridge. You need to step up and show that you're ready to take over. And in that way, this Olympics is so important. Michael represents the next era American male figure skating. triple axles, triple lutz, and he's doing it 4.18 into the program, and it's a beauty! I met Michael when he was 7 years old, before he even started skating, and to be sitting here calling his Olympic program is such a thrill, and to skate this well. Wow. Congratulations, Michael. You came to the Olympics, you made your statement.
His wife, Lisa, who choreographed that program. The Weiss clan, they've been staying in the resort city of Karawazawa about an hour and a half by bus from Nagano. His dad, an Olympic gymnast in the 1964 games held in Tokyo.
Quadruple Lutz, by far the most difficult jumping performed in this competition. You'll see he's a quarter turn right there, just a quarter turn shy. Looks like right there on the toe, it just didn't get off as much as he usually does. The next jump was so important, triple axel right here. Watch it land, and it'll reach right back, and it'll just crank a triple toe loop. A little 2 foot on there, but I'm sure the judges wouldn't notice that. They get so excited. Looking at his jumps, you can see the missed quad there, the triple axel in combination, the triple flip in combination. Wow.
Throughout his career, he has had only one coach, Audrey Whittaker. She sits by his side, as does his wife, Lisa.
Great marks. You know, you fell on the quad lutz, but it's a quad lutz. Hello. 5.756.
Carolina, love you guys.
The most important thing he needed to do at this Olympics is to say, here I am, and that's exactly what he did. He'll be a force for the next 4 years.
Just a wonderful performance by Michael Weiss. Meanwhile, earlier today, all three American ladies shared practice ice for the first time. Tara Lipinski and Michelle Kwan have been here all week. Nicole Bobek arrived in Nagano yesterday. The ladies' short program next Wednesday night on CBS. Guo Zhengxin of China will be next to skate. He has not one, but two quadruple jumps planned.
If there's one element that could make or break tonight's championship, it's right here, the quadruple toe loop. To help you visually follow this demonstration, we're going to paint the skater's right side orange and the left side green. What makes any jump difficult is the number of rotations, and the quadruple toe loop is four rotations. The skater is gliding on the right foot, toes with the left, works like a pole vault, shooting the skater up into the air, rotating counterclockwise, the right leg comes through, and they're gonna transfer their weight over to the right side in a snap of the hips that starts the rotation. It's gotta be high and quick and tight because you've gotta complete four revolutions landing backwards on the right foot. The rotation is so tight, so fast, it's very difficult to stop. Again, you'll see gliding right, vaulting left. It goes up and over the right side. One, two, three, four, backwards. Skater's gotta stop that rotation and control the landing. Height and distance so important because of the number of rotations. Each skater do it a little different, maybe a little smaller, maybe a little bigger, but this gives you a great guide on how big this jump is. All happens in less than 1 second. One more time, the quadruple toe loop is up, over, four revolutions, landing backwards on the right side. A high-risk element, this one jump will have a major impact on the outcome of tonight's competition.
1997 World Figure Skating Championships in Switzerland, Go became the first skater to ever land two quadruple jumps. And he will attempt them both tonight. 18 years of age from Harbin in northern China, a city of 3 million. Here is GUO Zhengxin.
Beautiful jumping technique. Jumping combination is triple axel. The landing was a little goofy, so he didn't take off for the triple toe loop. Just means if he repeats the triple axel, he has to do it in combination. Next is the quadruple toe loop. Quad, 1 foot in the double toe loop. That was so big and easy. Triple lots. See the control and the landing. It's a pure jumper. It's just beautiful to watch. Skated a clean, beautiful short program. His 10th place finish was purely on the second mark. He was in the fives on his first mark and in the fours in his second mark. You don't see that very often. The judges didn't like the program. Second quad will be right here. Too tight on the takeoff. Feet too close together, he tripped himself. Stamina. 4.5 minutes of gymnastics, basically.
Become the first man to ever land two quads in an Olympic program.
know he knows how to jump. If he wants to improve his placements on this level, he's going to learn how to skate. It's everything in between that'll bring him down.
Go Zhengxin, 18 years of age. He is part of the emergence of this sport in the vast country known as China. One of three Olympians from the city of Harbin. And of course, his Chinese teammate, Liu Chen, will skate in the ladies program next week.
Look at his elements. You won't see this very often right here. This is something that's going to take a while before the rest of the world wants to do two quads in one program. And of course, you have to do one in combination. Triple axel. Wow, he's got so much talent. He just has to learn how to skate in between. First quad, look at the height, the tight air position. He gets right into the rotation. Easy 1 foot landing, and he has to add this right here. Double toe loop if he wants to repeat the quad. He just gets right into the rotation. It goes snap right there. 1, 2, 3, 4, out, 1 foot. And he has to, if he's gonna repeat that jump, he has to do it in combination. Second one, a little looser in the air, maybe a little touch down there, but you can see it in his face. He's like, yeah, no legs, and I'm able to do the quad again. Wow. A little looser in the air, not quite as tight because your legs are so tired. And let's see if he put his foot down. No, he was able to. 2 1-foot landings on quads. That was over 4 minutes into the program, and I thought he was just fried. I didn't think he had anything left.
Now, the first set of marks for Go Zhengxin.
It's going to be interesting. 5 sevens, you get credit for the two quads. Great marks, but the second mark will go way down because it really isn't a program yet. He just has to pay more attention to that.
And here are the marks for presentation.
We go from 5-6 to 4-9 from the Japanese judge.
Oh, that puts him second, and he is second behind Michael Weiss, who had a wonderful Olympic program. And Michael is with Tracy Wilson.
Michael, we'll see other attempts at quads in the men's long program, but none as difficult as the quad lutz, which you tried. Take us through the quad for us and your attempt in your long program.
This one I felt good going into. I had a lot of confidence because I hit the one in the warm-up. This one I towed in. I was a little bit sideways in the air. I got around the four rotations, but slightly sideways on the landing, and it was good that I definitely got up and finished the other eight triples because, you know, there is a whole program, 4.5 minutes, and that was only, you know, a 2-second jump.
Is it tough to keep your focus after you go down like that, or is that something you practice?
I think it's something that I've practiced. You know, it's just one jump in the program, and there's eight other triple jumps that I have to concentrate on, and I think after a spill, it just makes you focus a little bit more, and I think this was probably one of the most difficult competitions for me to get through. You know, earlier, right before I left, I smacked my hip, and I've been kind of laboring a little bit, and that's made me get some pulls other places throughout the week. So it was good for me to not be able to practice at full potential all week and then come out and really, really pull it out when I had to.
Your first Olympic Games, did you meet your expectations?
I think so. My expectations were to have fun, and I came here. You know, my whole family was here cheering me on. Had my wife here when I came off the ice, and it was great for me to get a good program in after my short program the other night.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Todd Eldridge, United States. Ilia Kulik, Russia. Elvis Stoiko, Canada. They skate for gold. We return to White Ring.
We'll have more of men's figure skating later, but next.
To understand Ilia Kulik, you must know that he was born in Russia. In Russia, where skating is about movement, finesse, and strength. This style is often judged to be the highest standard in the sport. 4 years ago, Russian Alexey Ermanov won gold with this style. Ilia Kulik not only has grace, he has the powerful jumps worthy of a gold medal tonight. Elvis Stoiko. Brian Orser. Kurt Browning. Canada's best. But for Canada, Olympic silver is the best that country has ever taken home. Perhaps tonight, Elvis Stoiko can change that. A gold for Elvis, a gold for Canada. 4:30 tonight, Todd Eldridge will have 4 minutes and 30 seconds to prove he's a skater worthy of an Olympic gold medal. What a moment for the five-time United States champion. It's been one decade since an American man has held the Olympic crown. 5 months ago, Todd lay sprawled on the ice with a dislocated shoulder. 6 years ago, he abandoned the sport. Now, Todd Eldridge has Olympic gold in his grasp. We come to you from the gorgeous venue known as White Ring, beautifully lit against a Japanese sky, filled to capacity inside for the men's free skate. This is the night we decide the men's gold medal. The last group of six on the ice warming up. And they stand this way coming into the free skate. Ilia Kulik of Russia on top. The current world champion Elvis Stoiko of Canada is second. Todd Eldridge, five-time United States champion, is third. Alexei Yagodin is fourth. And Philippe Candeloro of France is fifth. Free skate worth two-thirds of the final score. And here is Ilia Kulik, Scott.
This program is very tough. He opens with a quad, gets it going right away. He's got triple axel, triple toe combination next. Very difficult program. You can see a triple-triple combination on the bottom. That's the last thing he does in his program at 4:05 in a 4.5-minute program. It's extremely tough. You see how light and effortless his jumps are? Just a thing of beauty. Todd Eldridge, he tried the quad at the U.S. Nationals. You see the triple axel, triple toe, triple flip, triple toe, triple axel late. Again, this program is very much in his control. He lands it clean. Is everything clean? He can hope for the other guys to make a mistake or two, especially on the quad. He's getting very well since he's been here. Elvis Stoiko, again, a quad-triple combination. He's the first man in history to land it. This program is extremely difficult as well. You can see triple axel, triple toe in there, another triple axel right after that. And let's look at this, the animation on the quad-triple. You can see the quad's hard enough. You really need to keep the speed going. You need to get great height to get the four revolutions here, but you've got to keep the flow in the landing to get into that triple toe loop. Elvis is very capable of doing this. He's done it in competition before. He skates last. Triple loop here. Seems a little tight. I saw him miss a triple sow cow earlier in this warm-up. Alexei Yagodin. Triple axel, triple toe, quad toe, triple axel. You can see the difficulties. This program is so unreal. Triple sow, triple loop. Very difficult combination. He's struggling with a little bit of the flu, though. He had a terrible practice today.
And for more on the story of Yagodin's illness, let's check in ringside with Tracy Wilson. Trace?
I just talked to Alexei Yagodin's coach. He confirmed that he does have the flu and a very high temperature. I asked him when he got sick, and he said it was right after the short program. He had a shower and then with wet hair went to watch the other skaters skate. Then he looked at me, he shook his head. He said, do you know what idiot means? He says, oh. He's very young. He has much to learn.
And Tracy has very little time in which to learn it. He'll skate third in the free skate. Let's check the order of skating determined by draw. Kulik will be first, followed by Todd Eldridge. Then Yagodin. Stephen Cousins of Great Britain is fourth. Then Candeloro and Elvis Stoiko. We'll be right back. At the Olympic Winter Games, only one man has ever won the gold medal in the men's figure skating event. In his first appearance at the Olympic Games, it happened in San Moritz in 1948. Dick Button was that man. He is here tonight. as we all together watch 20-year-old Ilia Kulik of Russia try to equal that accomplishment. The music of Gershwin, Rhapsody in Blue.
If he's going to do the quad, it's going to happen right now off the top of the program. Quadruple toe loop. Yes! 1 foot totally in control. From Kulik all week. He ho-hummed his way through. finally a smile. I guess he is human after all.
Born and raised in Moscow, but now a resident of Marlboro, Massachusetts. He first burst on the international scene when, as a 17-year-old, he captured the European Championship. But he finished ninth in the world that year, 1995. And he's had an inconsistent career since then. But his jumping ability, Scott, is breathtaking.
All you can say is pure. It's so pure and so easy. And he's young. He's only going to get stronger. The quadruple toe loop off the top, so tight, 1 foot. Just watch the landing. So many quads are assisted with a second foot touchdown. He'll reach right back here. You saw the animation. He gets right into the rotation. 1, 2, 3, 4, 1 foot. And he says, I got this one. I got it. His coach, yes! Major hurdle. Then the next jumping pass, he goes right into triple axel, triple toe. Look at the height and position on this triple axel. Beautiful. Lands right into the triple toe loop. 1 foot, beautiful.
And the first set of marks now for the first skater in the last group.
I don't know what you've got to get. 5'7" from British judge, obviously leading room for the other competitors, but it's going to be tough for anybody to do a program that technically proficient.
And the artistic mark.
And he still skates young. He's only going to get stronger artistically. 20 years old, this guy is truly special.
He landed 9.
You look at his element chart, perfect, beautiful, gorgeous jumping.
And he has thrown the challenge to the rest of the field, among whom, next on the list, the 5-time United States champion. He has traveled a circuitous and sometimes tumultuous path to this moment. His mom and dad, John and Ruth Eldridge, watch as the United States champion, Todd Eldridge, skates to music from Gettysburg.
Tilted, but saved. is it a beauty? Right in the death drop.
Perfect in the disappointment etched in his face. But what service Todd Eldridge has given to his sport. In a long and distinguished career, Carol Lipinski, his teammate, Jenny Mino, his American teammate, look on. His mom and dad, John and Ruth.
Following Kulik, he heard the marks. He knew what he needed to do. That was a great program with one fall at the end. We can look at it, compare it to Kulik's. Kulik's program was unbelievably awesome, okay? It was great. Todd Eldridge's program was very, very strong. He has nothing to be ashamed of. He approached it with courage. He never gave up on the performance, and he threw a triple axel at the end. So close, but what an effort.
Longtime coach Richard Callahan will accompany him as they wait for the marks.
All right. Hard performance. We'll deal with it. It's all right. That's all right. We'll deal with it.
He singled the triple axel. Then where the double axel was supposed to be, he tried another triple axel. Look how close he came to the landing. He didn't get the height he normally gets, but your legs are gone at this point of your program. Just backwards. Couldn't land it. Just not the strength to land it. His dad looks on saying, oh, 2 years ago you landed that.
The marks for Todd Eldridge. Technical merit.
Technical merit marks now for Todd Eldridge.
Todd knew after Kulik skated that he needed to be clean if he had any chance for the gold. But now we have to wait and see what color the medal's going to be or if he can even stay on the podium.
Marks for presentation.
It's a beautifully constructed program. He skates with a lot of maturity. Great champion.
All nine judges place Eldridge behind Kulik. Alexei Yagodin will be next. Elvis Stoiko last. Welcome back to White Ring. We continue with the men's final and the last group of skaters on the ice. When Dick Button won his first gold medal in 1948 in San Moritz, he was 18 years of age, the youngest Olympic champion ever. Tonight, Alexei Yagodin from St. Petersburg tries to better that mark. He's 17.
Watching him in practice, I thought he was bulletproof. feel good. It's so difficult to approach these jumps with the same confidence. Triple axel, triple toe, triple axel, triple toe, and I don't have any idea how we got the triple toe loop off that landing. Maybe he is bulletproof.
That's the first time he's missed the quadruple toe loop in his last six competitions. He had hit five in a row.
Kulik is a finesse jumper. Alexei, strength. But again, he barely hung on to the triple axel at the beginning of the program, and that one he just couldn't hang on to.
Yagudin came in fourth position and with a clean skate had a chance to move on to the podium. Had a chance, as a matter of fact, to win the gold medal. But that seems to be gone.
Lots. He just looks slow here. Not nearly the height he normally gets. Nice landing. You can see he's a little bit loose, his arms. Not skating with nearly the conviction we've seen him skate in the past. Normally a triple. What happens when you get tired is everything loosens up. Everything gets kind of pliable. You want to be straight, strong, tense. If your body isn't lined up perfectly, it's a split second timing. Triple sow. Triple loop. Again, a little low, a little bit sluggish on the landing.
Obviously feeling the effects of the influenza, Alexei Yagudin and his free skate.
At 17 years old, you're going to look ahead, Salt Lake, 4 years past that. Two Olympics from now, he'll be 25. Most of the guys competing for the gold medal tonight, except for Ilia Kulik, are 25, 26. So he hasn't even begun to reach the peak of his career.
And while we await his marks, let's check in with Tracy Wilson, who is with Todd Eldridge.
Todd, your thoughts on how you did tonight?
Well, you know, it could have been a lot better. Disappointed with the way I skated tonight. You know, I didn't feel too bad in the warm-up. Maybe I should have felt worse in the warm-up, like the short, but, you know, it's the way it goes. Sometimes it goes your way, sometimes it doesn't.
You had trouble on the second triple axel. Tell me about that.
Well, I think the first time I tried it, I just tried a little too hard, and the second time I was a little too tired. But, you know, it's something that, I don't know, the second triple axel wasn't that big a deal to me. You know, it's just the way that the whole program seemed to go. It just didn't go right. Didn't feel good, and you know, it just could have been a lot better.
Okay, thanks, Todd.
All right, Tracy, now the marks for Alexei Yagodin.
These aren't bad at all. He really struggled throughout the program. He didn't skate with the normal speed and attack and strength that really is who he is. 5'8 from the Russian judge is very generous.
Second set of marks for Yagodin.
Lack of speed. Again, very generous marks.
Three skaters remain. And here are the current standings. Kulik first, Eldridge second, Yagodin third. Elvis Stoiko will be the last skater on the ice. Back at White Ring and on the ice in sixth place, entering the free skate and competing in his third Olympics from Great Britain, 25-year-old Stephen Cousins. The music from the movie Gone with the Wind.
Had a long career. He's waited a long time to be in this position of being in the last group at the Olympic Games. His opening triple, a triple lutz. Beautiful. Element is triple axel combination. Triple axel short of rotation, quarter of a turn.
second triple axels coming up here. He really needs this. Double axel. 3.5 minutes into the program, you're starting to lose your legs.
His mother and father, Dave and Val Cousins, have made the trip here to Japan to watch Stephen Cousins compete.
I was so hoping that he would just nail this thing. Steve and I have been friends for years. We play golf together all the time. And he's worked so hard with each competition. He's trying to break through, trying to break through. He's been very patient. Triple Lutz at the beginning of the program was just gorgeous. Look at the height, air position, 1 foot landing. Triple axel came right after that. Watch the landing. Again, he gets into the rotation. Okay, not as big as it normally is. You can see just a quarter turn. Couldn't hang on to the landing. His mother looks on and says, oh. Next time. Next time.
Stephen Cousins now lives and trains in Toronto, where he represents Great Britain. His coach is Doug Lee, who also coaches Elvis Stoiko. And the two of them look at Stephen Cousins' first set of marks.
Really, the only thing he struggled with in that performance was the triple axel. Everything else was nicely delivered. Very mature skater, great crowd contact. His second mark will probably go up. Second mark goes up. A great Olympics for Stephen Cousins. The triple axel left him in the long program, but still, a great effort.
Elvis Stoiko yet to skate. We'll be back. We're back in Nagano, White Ring, men's free skate in 1994 in Lillehammer. Philippe Candeloro of France played the godfather. And he made it to the podium as the bronze medalist. Now he returns to the Olympics playing the role of D'Artagnan, one of the three musketeers. And hoping to grab another spot on the podium, here is 25-year-old Philippe Candeloro.
Landing. Competitive skating and put the audience first. The judges are incidental. They didn't pay to get in.
Also enormously popular in this country. He premiered this program when we were here Thanksgiving weekend for the NHK trophy. It was an exhibition for Candeloro, and this normally reserved Japanese crowd stood as one at the end of the night. After he won bronze in Lillehammer, he came to Chiba, Japan, and he won the silver medal. It was then, he said, that his popularity began to grow throughout this country.
You watch him technically, and you wonder how he gets the job done sometime, but he did. He got the job done, and the strength of his skating is the fact that he puts the audience first. And again, the nine people didn't pay to get in that are throwing up the mark, so he doesn't really care about them. I didn't think he could top the Godfather routine. He did. And what a difficult place for Elvis Stoiko to be in, to skate after the showstopper. When you're trying to win an Olympic gold medal against a perfect performance by Ilia Kulik. Triple axel, triple toe. Look at the height he gets. Up and in. straight, a little bit crazy there. Let's see if I can get the next one out. One, two, three, and out. I got it. Beautiful triple axel, triple toe combination. Second triple axel, he almost had it. It's the end of the program. Right there, you see he's tilted a little bit outside. Left hip goes open. Can't hang on to the landing. When you look at the jump charts here, you can see Eldridge Candeloro, 7-5. Huh? The triple axel fall, Todd Eldridge. Might have cost him. We'll see what the marks do.
And here's the judgment of the nine.
Well, you can see, again, the judges understand technique, and they know that Philippe's technique's a little bit out of control, but his second mark will go way up because his strength is in the program.
And here's the second mark. Whoa!
5'9", a 6.0 from France.
And those marks place him ahead of Todd Eldridge. Candeloro, bronze in 94, currently in second behind Kulik. And in the midst of the commotion, the current world champion, Elvis Stoiko. No Canadian man has ever won Olympic gold. This will be his sixth competitive Olympic program. Five previous programs, two in France, two in Norway, one here on Thursday night. He has never missed a jump. He'll need to be clean for the next 4.5 minutes to have a chance for Olympic gold.
If you had to put anyone in this position, this is the man that can get the job done. So tough, physically and mentally. Difficult. His next jumping pass will be the quad. Don't be surprised if he lands a good quad, if he throws a triple toe loop on the end of it. Quadruple toe loop. Triple toe loop.
Stoiko has been battling the flu like others in the Olympic Village this week. This morning at practice, he singled all of his jumps. Now that, perhaps, Scott, was by design.
He always does that. Day of competition, he saves it for the performance. But if you ask Elvis once if he was sick, he'll deny it. He does not want that to be an issue in this competition. Next jump. jumping pass is probably the most important after the quadruple pass that he tripled. Triple axle, triple toe combination. When Kulik set his program down, Elvis's program became a minefield. Triple axle. Triple toe loop.
Is obvious. Ilia Kulik back in the training room. He was the first of the last six to skate.
Elvis skated a little bit slower, a little more tentatively than he normally does. That's not skating with the same fire and intensity. His mother looks on. You won't find a better trained athlete in any sport anywhere else. He works so hard. What a difficult position to be put in. And it looks like he's in a lot of pain.
Come on, hang on.
Stop.
His mother, Irene, his dad, Stephen, back in the Toronto area, did not make the trip. Kulik waits as we do.
Great skate, Elvis.
He's not run through his complete program in the last 4 days. I think it's obvious that he has an injury.
Before he left, I heard rumors that he severely pulled a groin. And he was fighting it at Canadians, and he was fighting it throughout his preparation all the way here. He doesn't like to talk about things like that. He doesn't want anything to be an issue in the competition except for the skate. He's a terrific sportsman, but at the end of his program, you saw the pain that he was in, and you can see it now. When the shoulders come up like that and you squint, you know something's hurting.
Love you, Elvis.
Oh,
The marks for Elvis Stoico.
Now the assessment of the judges.
5 sevens and 8s. Won't get the job done in this competition. And if it holds the form, the judges will go down in the second mark.
Presentation.
Here is that mark.
Again. In a night of incredible skating for Elvis Stoico to go last after all of that and hold it together for 8 triples, the quad made the difference.
His mom, Irene, looks on. Philippe Candeloro defeats Elvis Stoico in the long program, but Stoico does hang on for the silver. Ilia Kulik gets the first place ordinal of all 9 judges. Stoico repeats as the silver medalist. Philippe Candeloro repeats as the bronze. And Todd Eldridge of the United States winds up 4th.
The 18th Olympic Winter Games on CBS.
First time in 50 years that a first-time entrant in the Olympics has captured gold. 20-year-old Ilia Kulik.
And he's only just beginning.
Elvis Stoico still obviously exhibiting the effect of the groin pull.
He took his skates off. All around pain. He came into this Olympics with so many hopes, so many dreams of being the Olympic gold medalist. 2nd 4 years ago, his mother looks on.
Elvis Stoico repeats as a silver medalist. Philippe Candeloro repeats as the bronze.
And coming into this competition, I don't think anybody gave Philippe much of a chance. 2 beautifully designed programs, short and long, and he plays to the crowd. Really the only man in the event that did that.
Well, the composition of the podium, identical to that of Lillehammer. Russian, Canadian, and French. It's the Russian at the top that's different. It was Alexei Ermanov in 94. This was the scene moments ago in the kiss and cry area. Elvis Stoico assisted into the back hallway by his coach, Doug Lee.
And you can deny the pain for so long, and then it all kicks in at the same time. Becomes unbearable. Groin pulls are so painful. It hurts every time you move your leg, and think about it, he was 1 jump, a quad from clean this whole competition.
That's the German team physician on the left helping out. Elvis's mother Irene following, concerned.
Six performances, 3 short programs, 3 long programs. Just about perfect in his Olympic experience.
The medals are being presented by Richard Pound, member of the International Olympic Committee from Canada. Tatiana Tarasova looks on as Ilia Kulik receives his gold. Courage. Elvis Stoico gets silver.
I heard rumors before the Olympic Games that he pulled a groin and he was really in a lot of pain. You need to be so tight and so quick in a quadruple jump. He pulls it and it ends up triple. See, right there he goes in, and you need to be so tight and it's right triple. Can't stay in the rotation if your leg's hurting. And despite all that, triple axel, triple toe, triple axel. Watch this triple axel, triple toe. He goes right up into the rotation, straight up into the air. One, two, three and a half backwards. A little bit forward and slow in the landing, but triple toe. Look how tight he is in the air. And triple toe, 1 foot. Beautiful landing. The last triple axel, he steps right up. Later in the program, when you're more tired, and just makes it around. Low on the leg, fights for it. 1 foot landing.
And the playing of the Russian national anthem.
Thank you. Please be seated.
Arigatou gozaimashita.
Kulik, Stoico, and Candeloro atop the podium in 98. That trio followed by Todd Eldridge, who slipped to fourth. Yagadine was fifth. Stephen Cousins, sixth. Michael Weiss jumped from 11th to seventh. Guo Zhengxin of China finished eighth. Michael Tillison of Denmark was ninth. Zagorodniuk finished 10th. Jeffrey Langdon of Canada, 12th. Takeshi Honda finished 15th, and Misha Shmurkin of Israel finished in 18th position.
Coming up, Jim Nance will visit with gold medal winner Ilia Kulik when the Olympic Winter Games continue on CBS.
Jim Nance back with you in Nagano, updating Elvis Stoico. He has not left his room at the Athletes Village since the competition and has turned down all interview requests. However, we are fortunate to be joined by the man who proved to the world last night that he's indeed the Olympic champion, no doubt about it, Ilia Kulik. I mean, that was a flawless program, I thought. Have you ever skated better than last night?
No, it was my really best skating in my entire life, and I'm so happy with that.
At what point in your free skate did you say to yourself, I think I may have won the gold?
In the very end, you know, when I did the last movement, when I stopped and I heard the music stop, I realized that because, you know, nobody knows where you can fall because there's the sport and there's the life and there's the skating ring. So after I finished, I realized that I could do this.
Of the top seven skaters, you were the only one to land the quad. How important was that, you think?
It was a key jump for me. It was a key element. And after that, everything goes smoothly and easily because it was a real tough moment for me.
You know, you didn't look at all nervous. Were you nervous? This was the first time you'd competed at the Olympics, the last to win the Olympics, and his first try was Dick Button in 1948. I mean, at the end, you were all smiles. What were you feeling?
I was really nervous. I was really nervous all that 8 days that I'm staying here, but you know, I'm trying to concentrate on myself and try to concentrate on my work, and I got it. I could deal with my nerve, but you know, on the last day, I thought I couldn't do this, you know, because it was so hard. I was so nervous, and I don't know what's helped me to concentrate.
Well, your family wasn't here. How soon after the competition did you get on the phone back to Moscow?
Yeah, I called right away, right after my skating. I took the cellular phone and called right away. I didn't even know what the place, but I knew what I did clean, and I called and told that everything's good.
Other phone calls too, back home?
Yeah, for my girlfriend.
How about, what do you plan on doing now that you've won Olympic gold? Do you think you'll want to stick around and go for gold in Salt Lake City in 2002? Have you thought about it?
No, that's a long way. It's a long way forward, and I don't know what it's going to be. I'm trying not to think about that right now because I'm just relaxed right now. I was so tired and trying to relax.
Did you get much sleep last night after the competition?
No, I was so excited. I gone to bed about around 6 o'clock in the morning because I couldn't just sleep and I couldn't have a party. I was so excited. It was so bad.
What do you plan on doing the rest of the week? I know you have to skate in the exhibitions. I know you look forward to that too at the end of the week, but what in the meantime will you do?
I'll try to see some competition. I really want to see the hockey game. I really want to see skiing. And so many plans to do.
Yeah, soak up the whole experience. Well, congratulations. I know you've made people not only happy in Moscow, but back in Marlborough, Massachusetts too, where you've been training since back in 1996.
Yeah, I just want to say thank very much because, you know, the people back to Marlborough and back to Moscow, they helped me so much with my injuries because the season wasn't so lucky for me. I had two injuries in a row. And it was real hard to deal with that. And, you know, I don't know what to do without the people back to Melbourne, back to Moscow, who helped me so much. I just want to thank them.
It was a virtuoso performance. Congratulations.
Thank you. Gold medalist
Ilia Kulik.
Thanks.
And we'll have more figure skating in Prime
Lap.
And I'm Donna Deverona. Welcome to TNT's exclusive cable coverage of the 18th Winter Olympic Games. Glad you're with us on this wintry day.
Canada's three-time world men's figure skating champion Elvis Stoiko spent much of Saturday evening in the hospital at the Olympic Village tending to an injured groin. In one of the more gallant moments of these games, Stoiko labored through his free program and still finished second. Afterwards, Stoiko's longtime coach Doug Lee addressed Elvis's condition.
He's got a torn abductor muscle, a pinched nerve in the groin area, and he's in acute pain. And we've had it basically for a month. It's happened at Canadian Championships. And we've tried to recover and put a work-recover basis. And we just couldn't get enough days off to get it healed. And we've taken more days off than we should have. I mean, everybody kept asking questions here. But we didn't have anything to tell anybody because it wasn't going to do any good. We're the ones that had to deal with it. And we were trying to get just that little one moment, that one chance, whether it was a short program. And we got through that short program. We created that chance. And then we had to spend the next basically 48 hours trying to recover and get our act together, and we did. And the window opened, and we just about got it out. But unfortunately, in the situation that we're in, we came up a little short, but it didn't matter about bronze medals tonight. The guy should have got a medal for bravery.
Second consecutive Olympic silver medal for Stoiko. Now, we are about to show you the results of the men's figure skating. If you want to watch the competition later on CBS, turn away. And when Donna begins speaking, you can rejoin us.
If one game can galvanize a sport, it would be Tuesday. Is trying to upend Russians Pasha Gushik and Evgenia Platov, who have won 21 events in a row. And as our skating magazine show the cutting edge details, the judges may have already given the Russians win number 22.
Welcome to White Ring, the site of figure skating. Midway through the competitions, already a controversy is brewing. Hi, everyone. I'm Alice Cook with Rosalynn Sumners and Peter Carruthers. It has to do with the compulsory dance and the defending Olympic champions, Gushik and Platov, who actually slipped on the golden waltz.
Absolutely. I think Pasha's going to keep herself in the news no matter what. In the compulsory dances, all the teams have to do the same steps. It's in the rule book. But take a look at this. You can really see very clearly where Pasha slips up. Now, ordinarily in skating, in single skating, pair skating, not a big deal. But in ice dancing within the compulsories, that's a huge mistake. And all of us here at the cutting edge give that a thumbs down. It looks as though Those judges are holding them up because they are the defending Olympic champions. Not right.
And even though the compulsory dances are only worth 20%, the judges really have sort of locked in first and second place. And the controversy is Shaylin Bourne and Victor Kratz, who are the defending world's bronze medalists. They're sitting in fourth place. And with two phases left to go, it's going to be so hard for them to move up.
Well, there may not have been a lot of affection during this event, but all the same, it is Valentine's Day. So here at the Cutting Edge, we thought we'd focus on the love side of skating. All of us grew up idolizing a certain skater, the one who inspired us to take up this sport. Here's a look at some of our favorite skating heroes.
I think it was 7 years old when I watched Brian Boitano win 1988 Olympics. I was stunned after his performance at the Olympic Games. I mean, having two people skate their best and judging that and watching it as a spectator, I was just like, who's gonna win? Oh my God, oh my God. I wanted both to win. I was like, it's not fair, you know? Can't both of them win?
When I was a little kid, and I remember I was watching 1988 Olympic Games, right? And Brian Boitano, he won that Olympic medal. And then Katarina Witt, right? And I was at home and I was sitting with my mother and she was telling me, look at those people, look how beautiful they are. Look how beautiful they are moving their arms. Oh my God, that's so amazing. And I was kind of just keep staring at TV set. And then I was trying to copy them.
And watching Brian and seeing him skate great performance after great performance and thinking, oh, he's perfect. You know, that really inspired me to want to be that good.
I find that as I get older, that there's a lot that I can contribute to younger skaters. A lot of people come to me for advice. It's amazing to me that they hold me with such esteem that they would like want to know what I thought and how they should treat a situation. And that means a lot to me. My idol was Terry Kubica, who was a national men's champion. And in 1976, he was the guy who did the backflip. But he was my idol because he was so technical. My whole career, I've always loved jumping and doing triples. And he was so far ahead of his time. He was doing every triple, you know, when guys were only doing one or two. So he was so technical and so consistent. That's why he was my idol.
I had a few idols in skating. Number one, Brian Orser. Training with him for a few years and talking to him and learning so much. He's always been my idol in the way he always went about his skating. And the philosophy he had of artistic impression and the artistic side of skating, I always focused on and really, really admired.
Elvis always had questions for me every session. I mean, I would be working away and trying to sort of master what I was doing and polishing my programs and getting ready for the Olympic Games and or a world championship. And Elvis would always come up, skate up to me and ask me to watch something. Or he'd have a question about technique on a triple axel or triple flip or triple lutz or whatever it was or wherever he was at that stage of his career.
My favorite pair, it's Gardiev and Grinko. And she's love too, and you know, it's best pair for me and nothing else.
Well, I think as a pair skater, I've always looked up to Ekaterina Gordieva, and I think I saw them skate in Cincinnati and I was skating singles then, and since that day, I always wanted to skate pairs and I kept bugging my parents, I want to skate pairs, and finally I did. And even competing with them at the Olympics in Lillehammer, I still looked up to them so much, and I still really look up to her as a skater and as a person.
For now, I would say that one of my heroes is Scott Hamilton, just because I think he's belongs to skate on the ice, to perform on the ice. He had such a wonderful personality which he can bring out for the people on the ice, and you can see it.
Scotty Hamilton, someone that's always had a great attitude. Attitude toward his skating, very fast, quick, energetic, crowd-pleasing. He's always been an idol of mine.
The first time I met Scott Hamilton was, actually I was at a seminar, and he just came into town, I think. He didn't really have anything to do with the seminar, but I was in the seminar, and I met him, and he gave me just a little bit of advice, and said, you're looking good, and exactly, you know, you're sitting there with your eyes open and going, wow, this is Scott Hamilton, oh my God, you know, and it's funny to think back on that, and now, you know, for me to be able to be, you know, really good friends with him, and I mean, I went out to Los Angeles and played a round of golf with him at his country club out there, and you know, it's really different now, and I think that's great.
For people to say that I've affected them in a positive way, I'll take that. Thank you. That's a compliment. And I've worked hard over the years, and I appreciate that very much. And that's nice. There's no higher praise, and there's nothing that means more to me than that.
Yeah. Well, I know I'm dating myself a little bit here, but my idol in skating was Janet Lynn. I love the way that she was smiling all the time, the way she carried herself. She was beautiful.
Gorgeous. Actually, my idols were on the ice, but in different sports. In 1980, Eric Heiden winning 5 gold medals and the hockey team winning gold. That really impressed me.
How about you, Roz?
Mine was Linda Frediani. I actually watched her win her national championship in Portland, Oregon when I was a little pipsqueak, and I just sat there mesmerized and said, that's what I want to do. She was small, she was perky and bubbly, and that did it for me.
Well, one person who's an idol for all of us, of course, is Peggy Fleming, and we'd like to wish her the very best during her recovery. That's it for today's show. For Rosalynn Sumners, Peter Carruthers, I'm Alice Cook, and happy Valentine's Day.
I'm living in Kyiv. I'm figure skating. I have to travel to long way to practice. It's very difficult, but it's no problem.
Welcome back, everyone. Tonight in our primetime show, beginning at 8 p.m. Eastern Time, you can see coverage of the ice dance competition in figure skating. Now, this is a sport that has been ruled for decades by Russians and outsiders. Even the most promising of pairs, such as Canada's Born and Kratz, fear the Russian dynasty is not about to fade very soon. Tracy Wilson has the story.
Everywhere they turn, Canadian Shailen Bourne and Victor Kratz see Russians. Behind them is a history of Russian dominance in ice dancing, and ahead of them on the podium are two Russian ice dance teams.
You know, I think it's been set in people's minds that the Russians should be in first, and I think we're changing that because it's not true.
Even when they're training in the mountains of upstate New York, Russians are never far away.
That was good.
For the past 2 years, Bourne and Kratz have trained with Natalia Dubova, who coached her Russian teams to 16 Olympic and World Championship medals. Dubova immigrated to the West 6 years ago, and she credits Bourne and Kratz for rejuvenating her career.
I love them. I spent lots of my time when I think about them. Victor and Shailene are different than other couples with whom I prepare. They're more fresh people. They're more athletic people.
Athleticism has never been a problem for Victor and Shailene. What they needed was some help with their style and someone to guide them through the often political world of ice dance judging.
She knows how Eastern coaches are coaching other teams and how the judges look at skaters from the West.
In ice dancing, judgment is a more worse thing than any other type of the skating, and especially you against with the Russian dominant ice dancing couple, you need to be two step higher.
In order to be two steps higher, Born and Kratz are taking ballet lessons for the first time from another Russian, of course. Unlike many teams, Shaylin and Victor rarely socialize outside of the rink.
We probably spend about 8 hours in a day together, so you need to re-energize and get away.
Shaylin re-energizes by spending time with her friends.
Come out here and play golf or watch movies. Lots of things. We don't get into trouble, but we have a good time.
And taking up a new hobby.
We're gonna give it a shot anyways.
Meanwhile, Victor has been relishing the stability of training in one place and buying his first new set of wheels.
The truck I own is the second most valuable thing I have. The first, of course, are my skates.
An Olympic medal is well within their grasp, and Natalia knows how to pave the way to the podium.
Coach must compete with the skaters, must be more calm than skaters. Coach need to protect skaters.
Born and Kratz are already champions to their fellow Canadians, and with Natalia's help, they're ready to win over the rest of the world.
Had such high hopes coming in, but here in Nagano, even their Russian coach hasn't been able to protect Born and Kratz. So far, they've been the victims of what's called block judging, groups of judges sometimes aligned regionally, teaming up to help each other's skaters. And it's caused quite a bit of disappointment and frustration for Shaylin Born and Victor Kratz. I spoke to them Friday night after the compulsories. They're happy that the issue has finally been exposed.
Prior to coming into this event, it really opened up. I mean, the closet opened and people know what's going on, but it's just the beginning. I think things are just starting to happen, and we're sort of in it at the right time and the wrong time, you know, all together. And like Victor said, we just have to perform our best no matter what's happening around us and not, you know, not give up or stop because of it, because that's, you know, we're in it for a long time and we want to make a difference, and hopefully we will.
Well, judging and ice dancing is one of the stories to emerge here in Nagano. What is the danger to the sport?
Well, you know, Tracy Wilson, one of our figure skating analysts, is very close to the situation, and she says that there are rumblings out there that if something doesn't happen to change this and to remedy the situation, that the future of ice dancing as a sport in the Olympics could be in jeopardy, which, you know, would be terrible.
All right, Andrea, thank you. There's also this news from figure skating. Germany's Tanja Shevchenko, expected to contend for a medal in the ladies' singles, has withdrawn from the competition because of the flu that's going around Nagano. She became ill here last week, and although Shevchenko is recovering, her coach didn't think her skating would, considering she had missed a critical week of practice. Her absence makes more likely a medal sweep by a very strong American ladies' team. Canada's Elvis Stoiko, the silver medal winner in the men's competition despite a groin injury he had been keeping secret, is receiving treatment at the Olympic Village. According to the Canadian Olympic Association, Elvis is very sore and will not skate in the exhibition here, and after Nagano, will be taking a few weeks off.
It's really sad to see Tanya Shevchenko out of the Olympics. She had fought back from a life-threatening illness about 18 months ago and fought, won some events this past season, and really, really wanted to compete here. It's a shame.
Absolutely. Well, before we go, here is
Tanya Shevchenko of Germany, who many considered a strong contender for a medal in ladies' figure skating, has withdrawn from the competition. She fell victim to the flu bug here in Nagano, and she and her coach made the tough decision yesterday to pull her from the games. Now, it was not what five-time world champion Todd Eldridge had come to the Olympics to do. He finished fourth and out of the medals in the men's figure skating final. Eldridge will probably not be back for another Olympics, but he is here with us this morning, and we couldn't be happier about that. Hey, Todd, good to see you. Todd, I came out, I saw your practice before the finals. Man, you were on fire. You hit every combination there was to hit. You hit every triple that there was to hit. I remember when we were done, somebody from skating said, you just saw yourself an Olympic gold medal performance this morning. What happened Saturday night?
Well, you know, I just didn't feel good. You know, I got into the building and warmed up, and I didn't feel too bad, but when I stepped on the ice for my performance, you know, things just didn't feel right, and you know, as anybody knows in sports, that happens sometimes.
When you were backstage and about to go on, what was going through your mind?
Well, I was really trying to focus in on my performance and what I needed to do in order to get out there and put out my best performance. And I was just backstage warming up and getting ready to go out. And I just had a sense in my body that it just didn't feel right. And that happens sometimes.
Well, I had a knot in my gut during your performance as well. And at the end of it, when you skated off, the look on your face, you looked so disappointed. Take me inside your mind then. What were you thinking about?
I was, you know. I mean, this is, you know, something that I waited for 6 years. And there have been a lot of ups and downs, a lot of bumps in the road, if you will, along the way. And to have the Olympics end up like that, it obviously isn't what I wanted to do. But we'll move on from here. And we've got the World Championships in 3 weeks. So we'll get home and we'll train hard and hopefully take that one.
Well, it was after your performance, I was outside about to get on the bus outside of White Ring, and I saw Tara Lipinski's mother. And she had a look of anguish on her face as well. And she said Tara was so upset. She was so upset at your performance, at what happened. Have you spoken to Tara since then?
Yeah, I have. And I told her that not to worry about me. I think I'll be okay. I told her to really concern herself with what she has to do here. She's got her own dreams of winning the Olympics, and that's where all her focus needs to be right now. And she's had great practices since then, so I think she's focused and she's ready to go.
She's got that fire in her eyes?
I think so.
Well, Todd, no mean feat. Five-time U.S. national champion, a world champion. Those are major accomplishments. Is this your last Olympic performance?
Well, I don't know yet. We're not going to make any decisions as of right now, but there are things that are kind of up in the air as far as new things going on in the sport that I'm just kind of hearing about now. So we'll see, what happens over the next few months and take it as we go.
So what happens next? What happens in the hours, in the days, as opposed to the months and the years?
Well, actually, all my energy right now kind of goes towards the ladies. I want to cheer them on and hope that, they all go out and skate their best, and maybe we could have a 1-2-3 sweep. So that'd be kind of cool to see.
Now, in the future, do you hear the lure of professional skating calling you, Todd? Do you hear it calling you?
Oh, it's out there somewhere, and it's calling. But it's something that in our sport now there are a lot of new opportunities and new competitions that say you've got open competitions where you've got pros and amateurs and you can do those competitions and there isn't the pressure now to have to turn professional to cash in and make some money. You can remain eligible and still make a pretty darn good living.
Well, Todd Eldridge, you are a champion. You're a stand-up guy for coming here and talking to us as well. Really appreciate it, and all the best to you.
Thanks.
Thank you. Jane?
So, more dancing coming up. One man who won't be dancing, though, on ice or anywhere else anytime soon is Canadian silver medalist Elvis Stoico, who joins me now. And Elvis, you fought through that groin pull in the men's figure skating final to take silver. How do you feel now?
Sore.
Still sore.
Yeah, really sore. It's a situation where not only a pull, but a strain on the groin and the adductor muscle, the lower ab. The glands and lymph nodes here are all swollen as well, so it's a matter of just taking some time and relaxing.
And you knew this was something that could pop up since January when you first injured it at the Canadian Championships. We actually have the tape of where you did injure your groin in your free program. Why don't you show us and tell us about it?
Sure. This actually, I was still sore in the warm-up, and this axle toe right here, right there, when I landed, something snapped in my lower ab, kind of near where the groin area is, and something gave out because it was really tight in the warm-up. It was really painful even beforehand, but after that point it was just really, really tough to keep going, but I was able to push through. I think the adrenaline and everything going, I think if that happened at the beginning, I would have stopped.
You got a great letter, I understand, after you completed the competition. Tell me about it.
Yeah, there's a little girl who sent me a fax, and I cried over this one because it hit me about what it really means to be here. A little girl named Jessica who had sent me a fax from Barrie in my own club. She's 5 years old. She says, Elvis, I'm 5 years old and I'm competing in my first competition this weekend. And I'm sick with the flu and I'm really scared I'm not going to be able to skate or be able to win. But I saw you skate and I know you were hurting and you were sick, and if you can do it, I can do it too. Mm. And stuff like that really gets you because you realize what it's all about.
You didn't get to try the quad, and do you walk away now, because gold was all that was on your mind, do you walk away satisfied, though, that you fought through it and still won silver again? How do you feel about that, with what you end up with?
Well, it's really a matter of fighting for what you believe in and dealing with the situation what you have. You know, when I came here, yes, I was injured, not as bad, because I got the flu, and that sort of changed everything and made it really difficult, and progressively got worse as the week went on. And it's a matter of dealing with what you have and not what you want. And, you know, there's nothing more I could have done. There's nothing more I could have tried to help the pain or try to, you know, get through it. I couldn't freeze it because they needed 48 hours ahead of time, or it's considered doping. And I went out there and I just gritted my teeth and I said, 2 minutes, 40 seconds, 4 minutes, 40 seconds, that's all I need. And when I look back on this 10 years from now, I'm not going to say I could have tried, I could have done more. I did the best I could and put in 100%.
I think everybody looks at it as a brave performance. I know you're going out to see Canada, USA play today.
Yep.
Who wins, real quick?
Well, Canada, but they're both great teams anyways.
All right. And unfortunately, Elvis will not be able to compete in the exhibitions later this week, but thanks for stopping by.
Thanks.
And coming up, we'll return.
Left the building, but not with the gold medal he wanted so badly in Olympic men's figure skating. That went to Russian Ilia Kulik, who skated almost flawlessly in the final. An injured Stoico put on a gutsy performance to take silver. And the bronze, that went to Philippe Condoloro, the charismatic Frenchman who brought D'Artagnan to life on the ice. We are honored to have all three in our studio this morning. Gentlemen, good morning to you.
Hi. Thank you.
Ilia, let's begin with you, gold medal winner. The first man to win a gold medal in his first appearance in the Olympics in 50 years since 1948, Dick Button. What's it like to be the gold medal winner?
I don't know yet, because it was only a couple of days ago, you know, it's happened, and I didn't realize what is it like to be the Olympic champion. But ask me this question in about a couple of months, and I'll tell you exactly what is it.
You were the only man to hit the quad, landed, it seemed like 100 triples. You said this was the best performance of your life that you've ever had. Why?
Why? Because I did everything like I wanted, you know, and it was such an important moment, and I prepared for that moment, and actually, you know, this season, I prepared for this moment, and I could do this. Yeah.
I told you, I have a suit that looks just like the shirt that you, the jacket that you had on there. You said people throw giraffes on the ice to
yeah.
you?
Yeah, I get so many giraffes. That's funny, but that's only Japanese fans, you know. They like my costume.
Afterwards, you were in the area waiting for your scores, and you had, thank goodness for cell phones. You called, yeah. You had Moscow on the phone?
Yeah, I called my parents, and I was so nervous, you know, about that, so I couldn't watch the guys skating, so I just sit on the phone, you know, and talking to my parents, just to relax a little bit.
Elvis, let's talk to you. Gutsy performance. Groin injury, torn up with the flu. You know, a lot of people were surprised you even made it out on the ice. How'd you pull it off, silver medal?
Well, I think that every day that I concentrated on just wanting to be at the Olympics and having the ultimate performance and just pushing it all the way through, I think got me through it. It's just believing in myself and never giving up. And sometimes, you know, the gold medal is not always, you know, the thing that you end up getting, but you gain a lot more from it. And going out and doing a great performance and skating the best of your ability. I've done that before. Ilia was able to do that. I was held back. I couldn't do it, but you deal with what you have. And I dealt the best way I could, but I still gave my 100% that I could. And I wanted to look back and say, you know, if I give 100%, that was all I could give. And if I look back 10 years from now, I can say I did that and not say, well, maybe I could have done a little more. You know, I couldn't do any more, and that was the best I could do at the time.
Scotty Hamilton talked to you a little bit about that. What did he tell you about giving all that you've got?
Well, Scotty talked to me after the short program, and it was really funny because he knew what kind of pressure I was under in the situation. And I came out with the short program and skated clean, and under the circumstances, all the guys had skated well. And he said, you know, 10 years from now, you're going to look back, and this moment's going to change and be a big part of your life. And no one knew that I was injured. And I had not told him yet, and I said, Scotty, I'm going to talk to you after this whole competition's over. I want to tell you something that's really important, and hopefully get a chance to talk to him. So I haven't talked to him yet about it, but what I actually went through before I went out to do that short program, not only with the pressure, but with my injury. I had only done one run-through of my short, half a run-through of my long, all week. dealing with the flu for 4 days and my injury, trying not to make a big deal over it, just to focus on it and keep it hush-hush. And, you know, and it was hard. It was really difficult. But I won the challenge. I was able to do it and, you know, pull it off and, you know, gain a silver medal. So I think that was a big thing.
These last couple of days, I know you've been limping after your performance. We in White Ring said, he's hurt. I could hear it around. Elvis is hurt. We didn't know that. After the performance, after you got your silver, you knew you gave your finest that you could give. There was a fax from a 5-year-old Canadian girl that sort of got you through. Tell me about that.
Well, there was a little girl that had sent me a fax, and she was from Barrie. I don't know the girl. She's 5 years old, and she said, "Hi, I'm Jessica. I'm 5 years old, and I'm competing in my first competition on Saturday. But I'm very scared because I have the flu, and I'm scared that I won't be able to win skate well. But I saw you skate and I knew you were sick and you were hurt and you did it. And if you can do it, so can I." And that was such a big inspiration for me. I broke down and cried for a while because I realized what it really means, what the Olympics really means. And I think because what I strive for, to have that ultimate performance and go for gold, that's what got me to this point. You know, you don't always get what you want sometimes, but you take so much from it and able to move on in your life. And I'll be able to take this experience and learn so much from it.
Philippe, or should I call you D'Artagnan, because you were one of the musketeers out there. You came from fifth to get the bronze. You had White Ring in the palm of your hand with your performance. But afterwards, you said there were some people who did not think that you would make it up to be on that podium. The audience thought you should be there. Who were you talking about?
Well, you know, when I come in on the ice, not many people can think I can do it. But when I have seen Ilia Kulik skating, I say, oh, that's a big pressure. So, okay, now maybe it could be the first man after, and Elvis too, he could be the first. And me, I'm going on the ice after I have seen Todd skating and Yagudin skating. He didn't skate very well. So when I coming on the ice, I'm just thinking about, okay, have fun, skate good. And after the triple accent and triple tool, what I did in the beginning of the program, I said, okay, now you can play. And this is what I did. And the public loved my program, and so it was a very good surprise for me when I come in here.
Well, all the young ladies sitting around me were oohing and on. They loved the boots, but you came out, woo, we love the boots. And the ladies say, he's so handsome. Do you think about the women in the audience when you put together your performances? You were sword fighting and wearing boots and looking dashing on the ice?
Well, you know, when we try to do a new routine, we try to find something nice for the audience inside the program and have fun during the part of the program. We have to think about something nice, because like that we can forget when you are a little bit tired inside the program, because you have to think about a jump, but sometimes it's good to think about the audience, not only about the judges, and you can forget like you have something bad to your legs. It's good like that.
Well, tomorrow is your birthday. Joyeux anniversaire. Happy
Merci.
Birthday to you.
Merci beaucoup.
Philippe, also Elvis, Ilia, the champions. Can you hold up your medals for us? Show everybody what they look like back at home. There they are, silver, gold, and bronze. Thank you all three for being with us this morning.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Jane?
Marks in Japan speak.
Ever since Tara Lipinski was 5 years old, she's had a dream of winning an Olympic medal. At the age of 15, that might just sound like a pipe dream, but she's the current world and 1997 U.S. champion, and it just might happen. It may seem like a lot of pressure to put on yourself, but this tiny Texan is enjoying every minute of her Olympic experience. She's the only member of the ladies' singles team to stay at the Olympic Village, and she showed us around.
So how cool is it to be in the Olympic Village?
Oh, it's so great. It's everything you imagined, and it's just so much fun. All day, you're never bored, and you can go places and meet people, so it's pretty cool.
So the Olympic Village really is like a little town. And right here, there's a little sewing going on. I understand that you've been relaxing and creating in here.
Yeah, it's pretty cool. You can make little patches, and it has like the Nagano symbols, and you can put your name on it or the snowlets, so it's pretty fun.
Yeah, nice to have that kind of stuff to take home, too.
Yeah.
Does it help you relax a little bit to do that stuff?
It does. And I think being in the village and enjoying the whole experience and not just thinking about skating and just going out there and having fun is the biggest thing for me.
Sure. Wow. God, so impressed that you can say that in the middle of all of this. And here's the beauty studio.
Yeah, I already got my nails done here.
Let's see.
My nails. Oh, not gold. That nice, but
there
hey.
You go. But they're gold.
Yeah. Yeah.
Any significance there, Tara?
Well, it goes with my outfit, but
okay. It goes with the outfit. Maybe with something else later, I don't know.
Hope.
Dad's in town.
Oh yes, it's so exciting. I wish he could have come earlier, but it's okay.
What's it like to see him again?
Oh, it's great. I haven't seen him in like 3 weeks, so.
And you brought candy.
Yes, of course.
Dad understands.
I always get
these
that.
Now, Todd Eldridge skated. You were up in the stands. You guys have the same coach. I'm assuming you're pretty good friends.
Yeah, very good friends.
What were you thinking about when he was skating? Were you nervous for him?
I was nervous, and you know, it was a hard night, but he's Todd, so he'll come back.
Yeah. Did you learn anything from watching him skate?
Well, I think for me, I just know now when I go out there, I'm just gonna go for everything, do what I have to do, and just, you know, love to skate.
Nicole Bobek's in town now. The three of you guys are out on ice, you and Michelle and Nicole. The dynamic change in practice?
No, it's pretty much the same. I mean, it's a little different because you know them and, you know, you're on the ice with them, but when you're out there, there's so many things to think about. You don't have time to think, oh, there's Nicole or
you're not
Michelle.
Looking at her going, oh, man, she hit that jump.
No, no.
And I understand that St. Teresa is really important.
Yeah,
to you.
I believe in her a lot, and I feel that she's with me. So when I go out to skate, it always gives me a little comfort.
Now tell me the story of St. Teresa.
You know, I always used to pray. I wasn't really, really religious. But then, you know, things just have been happening when we say, like, the five-day novenas. And everywhere we go, we'd be in, like, a St. Teresa church. And so many things would happen like that, so many coincidences. But they really weren't. So then it's just happened, and now, you know, she's like my patron saint.
Cool. And you wear her medal when you skate?
I have my saint. I have two of them.
The gold is this close. You're so comfortable. You're so cool. Do you have it all in perspective?
I do. I mean, if it happens, it happens. If not, it's over. And you see that with all the other skaters. When they mess up, it's hard for that moment. But, you know, there's the next day, and what happens, you know, happens. And I feel that if I want to do well, I have the control, too. So
that's wonderful. That's really wonderful. That way you can enjoy it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I don't have to be nervous all the time.
And not being nervous all the time is a good thing when you're at the Olympics. Now, when you watch Tara Lipinski skate, you just kind of tend to forget that she's 15 years old. But she tells me that she does enjoy doing the same things as other teenage girls. She likes going to the mall, having sleepovers, and she's even learning how to drive a car now, Mark.
Tara Lipinski. What if the car is gold? We'll have to find out. Now, normally we recommend...